guys. Appreciate that very much. Christian life is a race. In Hebrews chapter 12, you have a Bible, you might want to turn there. If not, that's fine. I'll just quote the verse. Therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, what does that mean? We're surrounded. Whenever you see a therefore in Scripture, stop and see what it's there for. Therefore is a summary statement. So to understand, there's a context. Context is huge. You don't like your words being taken out of context. I don't either. Scripture should not be taken out of context. Oftentimes, if you have a question about something in a text, if you back up, oftentimes that question will be answered just by the context. So when it says therefore, he's summarizing what he just said in Hebrews 11. In Hebrews 11, that's God's hall of fame, which actually, God's hall of fame is not in Cooperstown, it's not in Canton, Ohio, it's not, God's hall of fame is really a hall of faith. Without faith, it's impossible to please God. For those who come to him must believe that he is, and that he's a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. It's not blind faith, it's faith in his word. It's faith that he is the God who cannot lie. Scripture doesn't say that he doesn't lie. It says he can't lie. It's not in him because of his character. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty. That's absolute moral purity. So you see, every guy in this room, there's some area of your life that you can't get your arms around and you can't get control over. It might be cancer. Might be a rebellious kid. It seems maybe perhaps your job's hanging by a thread. You're kind of waiting to hear what's going to happen this week. You know, or that promotion, will it come through or will it not? You can't control it. You see, it's out of your reach. Everyone in here, in some way, shape, or form, you're trusting God to come through for you. That's the Christian life. It's not blind. You're focusing on the Lord Jesus Christ, you see. And the men in Hebrews 11 were men who walked by faith. They've run their race. Now they're with the Lord. Well, we're not with the Lord yet. We're running our race. Therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every encumbrance and the sin which so easily entangles us, and does it not? My gosh. Yeah, sin's constant. It'll be nice to be free from that. But that won't happen until you take your last breath. To be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. In the interim, we're going to struggle. This is a tough race. Therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every encumbrance and the sin which so easily entangles us, fixing our eyes on Jesus. You see, that's the name of the game, is to fix your eyes on Jesus. Because you see, he's great. We're screwed up. There used to be a book 30 years ago. It was huge. It was in every airport. It was in every newsstand. Everywhere this book was. I'm okay, you're okay. You might remember that book. I'm okay, you're okay. I'm okay. One day I'd like to do a book called I'm Screwed Up, You're Screwed Up. We're just all screwed up. Are we not? Yeah, we're sinners. We're sinners. Now, some say we're not. Just been reading a book by Paul Young, the guy who wrote The Shack. And he's come out with a book. I think it's called Lies Christians Believe. And then he goes into detail, 28 lies that evangelical Christians believe. And he denies that... He denies that really we're sinners. It's kind of fascinating. Then he denies that he denies hell. And then he says all will be saved, whether you believe in Christ or not. And then that's just three. Go check it out for yourself. You see? This is a long race, and people get off track in this race. It's a hard race. It's a difficult race. Therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every encumbrance and the sin which so easily entangles us, and let us run, watch this, with endurance the race that is set before us, fixing our eyes on Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith. The reason we fix our eyes on Jesus is that I'm screwed up and you're screwed up. But Jesus is the author and the perfecter of my faith. He gives me faith. In Ephesians 2:1, I'm dead in my trespasses and sins. When you're dead, dead men can't change their condition. You just can't up one day if you're dead and you've been dead for 60 years and say, you know, I'm sick and tired of this. You ever gone down a country road with your wife and then the leaves are turning and you're just, you know, it's just a nice little drive and you get out in the country and there's an old church and old churches have cemeteries and, you know, you're just driving slowly and you go by a little church cemetery and all of a sudden you see a hand come out of the turf. And then you see another, you've pulled over now, you're watching this, this is fascinating. And then you see a head burrow up and this guy pulls himself out of the dirt, sees you there, says, hey, can I get a lift into town? Now, that's stupid. Nothing like that will ever happen. Guy said, yeah, I've been dead 60, 80 years. I'm just tired of this. Wanted to go into town, get a Diet Coke, and, you know, read a paper. That's just ludicrous. Why is that ludicrous? Because dead men can't change their condition. Spiritually dead men can't change their condition. So he made us alive. Faith is a gift of God. Ephesians 2:8, for by grace you've been saved through faith, and that not of yourselves, it is the gift of God. Amen. Not as a result of works, any man should boast, for we are his workmanship created in Christ Jesus for good works, that we would walk in them. God has a plan for your life. He gave you physical birth at a certain point. He gives you spiritual birth. You have to be born again, Jesus said to Nicodemus. And if any man is in Christ, he's a new creature. Old things pass away. Behold, all things become new. So now, those who are spiritually dead are now spiritually alive because Christ has regenerated you. He's opened your eyes. You hear the gospel, and you say, I believe, Lord Jesus, you went to the cross and died in my place. I trust in you alone for salvation. I turn from my old life, and I turn to you. And he comes into your life. And now, you're in the race. You see? Okay. But we fix our eyes on Jesus. Now that you've come to Christ, are you free from sin? No. You got a new nature, but the old sin nature is hanging around. So you just don't feed it. You don't feed it. It used to be the big, domineering, bully, huge guy in your life. You had to do what he said. But Christ has come in. Now you have a new nature. And now sin is this old guy in a wheelchair with oxygen tanks. And what you want to do with that guy, you want to kill him. You don't want to feed him. You don't want to give him steroids. You want to kill him. If by the Spirit we are putting to death the deeds of the flesh, we shall live. There's a process. So here's the deal. You see, what I'm talking about is a process. This race is a race from immaturity to maturity. And by the way, it's a long race. The Christian life is not a sprint. You say, how do I know that? Well, it says right there in the text, let us run with endurance the race that is set before us. If you're in a sprint, you don't need endurance. I would always try to watch the 100 meters in the Summer Olympics. And now you don't have to actually, I mean, I used to make sure whenever it was on, I'd watch it, but now we got all this technology and you can record it. It's great. But man, for years, I'd always make, when's that 100-meter race coming on? And I'd make sure I watch that thing. Those guys are the fastest in the world. You don't need endurance to run 100 meters. It's interesting, isn't it? Really, the key thing in the 100 meters is the start. The reason the start's so important is those guys at that level, the speed is pretty much the same. The steroid level is pretty much the same. So what's going to give you an edge? It's your start. So guys will try to anticipate the starter's gun, and that's why often you'll see a false start or two. They're looking for an edge. But you don't need endurance. You just need a great start. In the Christian life, it's not how you start that counts. It's how you finish. The name of the game is to finish strong. As I look at Scripture, it seems to me there are at least three ways you can finish. You can finish poorly in the Christian life. Nobody wants to do that. You can finish so-so. Nobody wants to just, I mean, an average finish, what does that mean? At a certain point, you just kind of lose your passion. You just kind of put it on cruise control. You know? Start compromising your convictions. Just kind of sailing. You don't want to do that. Because you're not going to make an impact. We want to finish strong. The problem is we struggle with sin. We're talking about mission statements earlier. First time, everybody talks about mission statements. From what I can remember, I never heard anyone talk about mission statements until Stephen Covey's book came out in the mid-80s. And he made a big deal out of having a mission statement. A mission statement? Oh yeah, you gotta have a mission statement. What's a mission statement? Well, you know, he'd take these guys off on retreats and these corporate guys, these CEOs, they get 2 or 3 days away from their office, they go to some island, they'd spend thousands of bucks to get away just to be able to think and think through their life and what's important. And you put it on a page, no more than two. He said, you know, you can change it, you can play with it, you can, and some guy, you know, you just keep altering your mission statement. It keeps you on track. When I turned 40, I wrote a mission statement. It didn't take me a weekend. I haven't changed it in 27 years. I wrote it in about 5 minutes. Allow me to share my mission statement with you. My personal mission statement is, don't screw up. That's it. It's not real religious, but I don't want to screw up, do you? I don't want to screw up and leave my wife and my kids and my grandkids. I don't want to do that. But I meet next week with a guy who's done that, 3 years ago I was doing Bible studies with. I mean, he just flipped out. And I'm amazed he's meeting with me because he wouldn't return my calls. And I'm going to meet with him next week. Something went haywire there. You see? I don't want to screw up. Now, the problem is I screw up all the time because I'm a sinner. But you see, this is why I fix my eyes on Jesus. I don't fix my eyes on me. I fix my eyes on Jesus, the author of my faith. I have faith because of Jesus. 1 Corinthians 15, I delivered you as of first importance. This is the most important thing in all of the world. Paul says, I delivered you as of first importance that Christ died for our sins. That's it. It's called substitutionary atonement. By the way, just reading this book by Paul Young, he denies substitutionary atonement. Now why am I bringing this up in the midst of this talk? Because the Shack sold 20 million copies. Some people loved it, some people didn't like it. And we're trying to figure out what's really the meaning, what's this guy saying in this book? Now he comes out and tells us what he believes. You know what he says about the substitutionary atonement, that Jesus went to the cross in my place? He calls that cosmic child abuse, and he calls the Father appalling that he would do that to his son. That's a denial of the gospel. The Christians, the believers at Berea were more noble than those who at Thessalonica because they searched the scriptures daily to see if these things were true. If you don't like what I'm telling you about that, you better search the scriptures. You better test the spirits, you see. Even if that book touched your life, You better test it according to the Word of God. Because you see, they went out from us because they were not of us. That's Scripture. Now, what I want to do is watch my own heart. I want to guard my own heart, for from it flows the wellsprings of life. You see, this race is a long race. And the problem is, am I a sinner? Yeah, I am. But you see, Jesus is the author of my faith. 1 Corinthians 15, you thought I forgot it. I didn't. I just had a senior moment. 1 Corinthians, and see, some of you forgot that I forgot it. Because you're my age. Yeah. I'm really enjoying this stage of life. I don't know where I am. It's great to be here in Idaho with you guys. 1 Corinthians 15, watch this. Paul said, "For I delivered to you as of first importance that Christ died for our sins." That's substitutionary atonement. Jesus went to the cross. He who knew no sin became sin. He took my sin. He took your sin. He paid for it. The reason the wrath of God does not come on me is because I'm in Christ. Jesus took it upon him. Jesus paid it all. It's an amazing thing. Amazing love. How can it be that thou, my God, would die for me? You love it. It's the greatest news in all the world. I delivered you as of first importance that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures, that he was buried, that he rose on the third day, that he appeared to Peter. Then he appeared to the 12. Then he appeared to 500 at one time, and none of them recanted. Lastly, Paul says he appeared to me. And then Paul goes on and says, if there's no resurrection from the dead, if Christ didn't come out of that tomb, we're fools and we've been duped. You see, this is the gospel. Jesus is the author of my faith. He's the finisher. He has started a work in me, and he will finish the work in me. Philippians 1:6, he who began a good work in you will bring it to completion in Christ Jesus. But you know what? He wants me to be teachable. And he wants me to be his disciple. And he wants me to fight the good fight. I said the Christian life is a race. If you guys like outlines, that's point one. Here's point two. When a man gets serious about Christ, the enemy gets serious about you. When you start following the Lord God with all your heart, soul, strength, and might, say, Jesus, I'm yours. I'm all in. I trust in you alone. I've been driving this car my life. I'm getting in the back seat. Would you drive this car? I'm riding with you. You're my Lord. You're my master. You're my Savior. You're my shepherd. You're my God. You're my sovereign defender. You're my keeper. You see? You just get all in with him. Now, when a man gets serious about Christ, the enemy gets serious about you. You see? Because now you're just not a Texas Southern Baptist Bible Belt church guy who's worthless. Now you really love Christ. You see? I know your grandpa was a preacher. Everybody in Texas, their grandpa was a preacher. But you know, now you're serious about the Lord. You love the Lord, man. You want to grow. You want to get to know him. You want to get to know the Word. Well, now you got a target on your back. And the enemy is going to try and take you out. Because you love Christ and he hates Christ, therefore he's going to try and take you out, and he's going to try and negate your influence for Christ. 1 Peter 5:8, your adversary the devil goes about like a roaring lion seeking whom he may devour. So count on it, in this race, you're going to get opposition. Now we're in a race. What's the goal of the race? The goal of the race is to finish strong. I find it interesting as you look at Scripture and you look at men in Scripture that so many men in the Christian life, Old and New Testament, who started strong did not finish strong. Why is that? Well, they have an enemy. If you look at Numbers 13, you remember the story of the 12 spies. They're going in the land. God took them out of Egypt, slaves for 400 years. God does 10 miracles, does another miracle. They cross the Red Sea, dry land. You know that whole drill. A few weeks later, Numbers 13, God says to Moses, pick 12 men, each one a leader, one guy from each tribe. Moses went around, hey, who's your best guy? Who's your best leader? They picked 12 guys. They go on a reconnaissance mission, 40 days. They come back. it's a great land, unbelievable land. They got, you know, grapes it takes two guys to carry. It's milk and honey. It's unbelievable. God says, I'm going to give it to you. I'm just going to dump this thing on you. I'm going to give you cities you didn't build. I'm going to give you orchards you didn't plant. I'm going to give you cisterns you didn't hewn. That means you got a water supply. But 10 of the 12 said, yeah, but there's giants in the land. Joshua and Caleb said, well, God will fight for us. He did the 10 miracles, and then he did the Red Sea. He can take the giants. But those 10 guys say, we can't take those guys. They just seen God do 11 miracles, and they say, we can't take these guys. Now, here is their issue. They were external leaders, but they weren't internal. Externally, they were leaders. Internally, they weren't submitted to the living God. They didn't trust him. They didn't believe in him. They were false professing believers. But when adversity comes, they wouldn't trust him. And because of their unbelief, which spread to the people, they had to wander in the wilderness for 40 years, and God took out the 10. And there's not a guy in here who can name one of those 10 spies. But you can name the two who trusted God, Joshua and Caleb, and we still name our grandkids after them today. Right? What I'm saying to you, there were 12 leaders, and out of 12, two finished strong. Years ago, I was working on a book called Finishing Strong. And I had remembered something that I had heard in class from Dr. Howard Hendricks, one of the great, great teachers, Bible teachers in church history. Just went to be with the Lord a few years ago. I called him up and I said, Prof, I remember that story you told. 200 or so, you surveyed 200. He goes, yeah. I said, can you run that by me, please? He said, sure. Surveyed 246 pastors, missionaries, worship leaders, youth guys. He said, all right, 246, I'm writing this down. I might use this in the book. You okay with that? Use it, Steve, it's great. I said, all right, 246, these guys are all in full-time ministry. Yeah. The reason I surveyed them is that all 246 got involved in adultery within 24 months of each other. Now, that's 20 a month. 240, no, how much is that? 240, see, I didn't really do well in math. I did well in English Lit. 246, 24, that's 10, right? Yeah, I did good in math. That's a math joke, and obviously you're wondering, why is this guy speaking to us? But you get the point, 246 guys. Now, I went to seminary with some of these guys. I know some of these guys. We were in school together. These guys love Christ. They'd die for Christ. Was that one of their life goals? Was that one on their mission statement? In 20 years, 20 years, I'm going to commit adultery and screw up my whole life? No. They never. No. But it happened. Tragic. And you keep seeing it happen. Because the enemy is still at work. He said, Steve, I found four traits. As we interviewed these guys, broken guys, just broken guys, we found four traits. Number one, watch this. They had no personal time in the Word of God. But you're saying they're pastors. Yeah. What do you mean they had no personal time in the Word of God? Well, they had been at it 15, 20 years, and what happened? They got out of the Word. Well, they got to preach. Yeah, but they've been doing it for 15, 20 years, and they got an arsenal, and they can get up and, you know, they can put something together in 20 minutes. But during their own private life, they got out of the Word. Well, why'd they get out of the Word? Well, they didn't mean to, probably. They just got real busy. Got to be at this meeting. Got to go to this. Got to go to this. Got to... Distractions. Distractions are everywhere. But the point is, they got out of the Word. No personal time in the Word of God. Number two, Steve, not one of them had any personal accountability. Chuck Swindoll says accountability is a willingness to explain your actions. There was nobody around them. They put a wall, they put a fence around them, and nobody could get close. They didn't have to explain anything about their behavior to anybody. Three, 80% of them got involved in immorality by counseling women. You say, well, I don't counsel women. Yeah, but you work with women. Before a guy ever falls sexually, he falls emotionally. There's a connection. There's a little sizzle in the fajita. that, you know, you work with her and you're on the same sales team and all of this, and there's a connection. You know what I'm talking about. You better be careful. So yeah, I don't counsel women. You know, these pastors, you got to watch. When you're a pastor, you got to be careful because you counsel people. And I talk to guys. And, you know, your marriage has ups and it has downs. I don't care who you are. Well, if you get caught at a down time and things aren't going real great at home and you're a pastor and some gal comes in and she's got a problem and she starts weeping and all of a sudden and she's attractive and she's looking to you and there's an emotional connection, you better be careful. Fourth thing, he said, Steve, fourth thing. This was amazing. Every one of these guys said, I thought it would never happen to me. Well, pride comes before the fall. Let him who stands take heed lest he, what? Falls. I try to pray because I scare myself. I'm afraid of myself. I know my heart. I try to pray every morning two things. Let not the foot of pride come upon me. It's happened too many times. Keep me from pride. Keep me from stupid. Second thing is, do not let me wander from thy commandments. Now, so Dr. Hendricks surveyed these guys. That's kind of frightening. Because you see, this is the enemy's strategies. Ephesians 6:10, be strong in the Lord and the strength of his might. Put on the full armor of God that you may be able to stand firm against the strategies of the devil. He wants to take Christian men out. That's what he wants to do with you, with me. He wants to take us out. And when I see these four traits, this is a pretty good indicator of how he will probably try to take us out. So what's the antidote? Let me give you the antidote. Let me give you four stays. I love the word stay. There's a great hymn, Stayed Upon Jehovah. Hearts are fully blessed, finding as he promised perfect peace and rest. That probably comes from Isaiah 26:3. I learned this in the King James Version, so I'll quote it with that. He whose mind is stayed on thee, thou will keep in perfect peace because he trusteth in thee. King James. Great verse. He whose mind is stayed on thee, on who God is, on what he has done, on what has he promised, what his spirit will do in our lives through his word. He whose mind is stayed on thee, thou will keep in perfect peace because he trusts in thee, because you're trustworthy. You see? But your mind's got to be stayed. Now here's the problem. It's hard to keep your mind on the things above because there's so many distractions and we're pulled so many different ways and we have so many different responsibilities. So let me give you four stays. To finish strong in the Christian life, you got to be purposeful. You have to be purposeful. And you got to have four antidotes to these strategies of the enemy. So here's the first one I want to give you. Stay in the Word. Stay in the Word. By their own admission, the 246 men who love the Lord, they got out of the Word. Did they just up one day and said, I'm done with the Bible? No, it was gradual. It was an ambush. It was a trap. I remember Joel Aldrich said one time, the enemy will wait 40 years to set a trap. He's very patient. Stay in the Word. Now, as long as you walk with Christ, you know that you're to be in the Word. I can read Sports Illustrated. I can read the New York Times. Not that I want to. I can read the Wall Street Journal. I can read anything. But if I go to pick up my Bible, I get resistance. Anything else, I don't get resistance. I've got to stay in the Word. Deuteronomy 32, it is not an idle word for you. It is your life. Matthew 4:4, man shall not live, Jesus said, by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. Every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God is right here. Vitamins, minerals, AEC, chromium, potassium, selenium, antioxidants, it's all here. You got to eat. You got to get nourishment. I meet Christian guys who revere the Word of God, they never read it. They're anorexic. And the enemy wants us all to be spiritual anorexics. He doesn't care if you revere the word, he just doesn't want you in it. Why not? Thy word I have hid in my heart, that I may not sin against thee. How can a young man keep his way pure? By keeping it according to thy word. Open my eyes that I may behold wonderful things from thy law. That's all in the opening of Psalm 119. But he doesn't want you in the word. You're going to have to fight to be in the word. Yeah, Steve, I don't know. I always struggle with this. Okay, let me give you, just real quick, let me give you a couple tips. Three tips. Number one, set a time. Just set a time. What's good for you? You a morning guy? You a night guy? Whatever you are. Just set a time. The Lord will be there. Set a place. What's good for you? Your breakfast table? At lunchtime, you sit in your truck? I don't know. You set a place, the Lord will be there. I got a Bible reading calendar that I've carried with me for years. I just carry it with me. If I read four chapters a day, it gets me through the Bible in a year. See? Why do I do that? At a minimum, that's what I have to do. Now, I study. I'm supposed to study the Word of God. But at the minimum, I got to put this in my heart. It's not only reading the Word, and I don't want to overwhelm you guys. You say, well, Steve, I don't know if I can do that 7 days a week. Well, then don't do it 7 days a week. What? Hey, listen, before you can run a marathon, you got to get a lap around the high school track without throwing up. Right? Right? That's where everybody starts. I can't believe it. I went 160 yards. That's where you start. Okay. So Ken Cooper, in his aerobics book that came out how many years ago, said, you know, he had all, you know, Jim Fix is running marathons, these guys are doing. He said, you know what he said? He said, if you work out three times a week, 30 minutes, and you do this point thing, you're good. Don't try for seven, try for three if you're not doing anything. Well, what if I miss a day? You missed a day. You got tomorrow. But get in it. Get started. You see, you can do this. It's just not reading the word, it's meditating on the word. Okay? Now, I want to say this. Don't lose me here and don't get distracted. Because this is where the enemy is going to try and distract. Okay? And I know you got places to go. But you need to hear this. Not because it's me, because it's from the Lord. When he spoke to Joshua, he said, this book of the law shall not depart from your mouth, and you shall meditate on it both day and night. Psalm 1 says, the man who is in the word of God shall be like a tree. And in, what does Psalm 1 say? I had it and then I lost it. Look at this. Meditation. His delight is in the law of the Lord. In his law he meditates day and night. He will be like a tree firmly planted by streams of water, which yields its fruit in its season. Its leaf does not wither. Whatever he does, he prospers. You want to be a big, giant oak tree. The roots go down deep, and you're drawn on the living water. You see? You see, I got a job. I can't meditate on Scripture all day. That's right. You can't. What is meditation? Eastern meditation is you empty your mind. That's not Christian meditation. You fill your mind. You guys remember Walt Garrison? Sure you do. The old cowboy fullback? He did a very famous commercial. You just take a pinch between your cheek and gum. For fine tobacco pleasure. So you take a pinch of chewing tobacco and you put it right in there. That's biblical meditation. So I have guys ask me, how do you memorize Scripture? I've never tried to memorize Scripture in my life. But as I'm reading Scripture, if a verse stands out at me, you know what I do? I mark it in yellow. You'll see yellow there. And then you got yellow, you know, here. And then I'll circle it. And if a verse stands out to me, you know what I do? I need to know this verse. I take three post-it notes. Just like this. I take three post-it notes. I write the verse down. I put one on my mirror in my bathroom. I put one on my dash in my car. And I put one on my desk. I don't try to memorize it. I just put three sticky notes with the scripture. 7 days later, I know the verse. Because every time I turn around, I'm looking at it. And you see, you want to know some verses because the word of God is living and active and sharper than any two-edged sword and able to divide between soul and spirit and joint and marrow, and able to judge the thoughts and intentions of the heart. You want to know Scripture. You see? You say, what about this meditation thing? You just take a pinch between your cheek and gum. I'm watching that clock. I'm going to ignore it, but I'm watching it. I got 2 minutes. Let me say this to you. Over the last, let me just, in the morning I get up, I get my Bible. And I'm going to read my passages. But here's what I do. I'll tell you what I do. I get my coffee, and quite honestly, I sit in the dark for a few minutes. And what I do is, I've done this for the last year, I quote to myself Lamentations 3. Because Lamentations 3 was the death of the nation. Perhaps in God's mercy we've had a little bit of a reprieve, but we are so close to tyranny, and you know it, and I know it, and I was concerned last year for my kids and grandkids. Okay, that's all I'm going to say about that. Lamentations 3, he's depressed. It's the most depressing book in the Bible. He says, I've lost all hope. But in Lamentations 3, he says, this I recall to mind, therefore I have hope. I quote this to myself every morning in the dark before I open my word. This I recall to mind, therefore I have hope. Watch this. That the steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His mercies never come to an end. They are new every morning. Great is thy faithfulness, O Lord. And then I take about 5 minutes, and I go through the day before, and I thank him, and I enumerate the mercies that I saw that he gave to me the day before. I thank you for that phone call. I thank you, Lord. I didn't expect that in that meeting. I just thank him, because you see in Romans 1, they didn't give thanks. I want to give thanks. And then here's the deal. I know that morning, in the dark, there's going to be a FedEx truck pull up with a whole box of mercies for me. And see, what that does is it gives me hope for the day. I don't care what's going on in the news. But you see, I got to meditate. I think through the facts about who God is. And what it does, it gives me hope. And I'm not fearful. Now, you don't have to do this for 4 hours. You got a job, man. You can't, you know, but you take some time. Dadgummit. I hate that clock. Sorry, just let me give you the last three. You stay in the Word. Secondly, you stay accountable. Because those guys had no accountability. Is there anyone in your life who can ask you tough questions and you'll tell them the truth and not lie? Anybody? We already heard today, what the enemy wants to do is isolate Christian men. He does not want you with other people. He wants you to think you're an island. Hey, there are two things in life you can't do by yourself. You can't get married by yourself. I mean, at least not yet. I'm sure there's some federal judge somewhere that's writing that and getting it ready. But for now, you can't get married by yourself. I'll tell you what else you can't do by yourself. You can't live the Christian life by yourself. He sent them out two by two, and you are to have at least one or two or three people in your life that you interact with on a deep level, and you don't lie to each other. And that begins with your wife. And then you're safe. Proverbs 13:20, he who walks with wise men will be wise. So get one or two wise people and walk with them, and you'll be fine. And then you look out for each other. Okay? Here's the third one. Stay away from women. Because 80% of them got involved with women. Here's a principle. Stay away from women emotionally. Well, we're just having lunch. Take your wife to lunch. Why don't you go take your wife to lunch, see what's going on in her life? Well, it's no big deal. It is a big deal. Why are you having lunch with her? Well, you know, a little sizzle in the fajita maybe. If there's a sizzle, get away from her. Go back 10 yards and punt. Cut it off. So you're kind of extreme. Jesus said, if your hand offends you, put it in a cast. You remember that verse? He didn't say that. He said, if your hand offends you, what do? Cut it off. When you're sexually tempted, you got to take extreme measures to save your life. Don't be stupid. Don't touch sin with a 10-foot pole. There's too much riding on this. Fourth, stay alert. Alert? Yeah, because those other guys, the 246, said it'll never happen to me. It can happen to you. It can happen to me. Well, how do I stay alert to the enemy? Stay in the Word. stay close to a friend, stay away from women, other than your wife. You get it. You're a gentleman with ladies and all that, but you got an emotional distance. And by God's grace and His mercy, He'll enable us to finish strong. You may be thinking, Steve, it's too late for me. No, it's not. You just run to Christ and repent of your sin. He'll get you back in the race. He's a great Savior. God bless you guys. Thanks, God. Appreciate you.
You guys made it all the way through. Congratulations. I'm Corey Huddleston with Wingmen Ministries, and I want to welcome you guys and thank you for taking the time to watch the video. If you enjoyed it, please give our speaker some love by hitting the like button just right below me right now. If it's your first time to visit the Wingmen channel, make sure you hit the subscribe button in the lower right-hand corner. You guys have a great week. We'll talk to you next time.